VOA Weather Hits.
Welcome to Learning English, a daily 30-minute program from the Voice of America. I'm Jonathan Evans.
And I'm Ashley Thompson. This program is aimed at English learners, so we speak a little slower and we use words and phrases, especially written, for people learning English. On today's program, you will hear reports from Katie Weaver and Dan Friedel. Faith Perlow answers an English question from a learner in Vietnam. We close the show with part one of Rappaccini's Daughter by Nathaniel Hawthorne. But first,
experts on China believe it is studying Russia's war in Ukraine to improve its own battle plans and policies connected to Taiwan. It has long claimed the island as Chinese land that is partly self-ruled. Russia makes similar claims about parts of Ukraine and gave such reason for invading the independent country February 24th. Russia has faced much stronger resistance in Ukraine than expected. International economic sanctions have weakened Russia's effort, and foreign military aid has strengthened Ukraine's defense. Some experts think China is looking at ways to take full control of Taiwan quickly. They think the military will attack the island's communications centers and major political institutions. An attack by sea is more complex, suggests Chen Yifan. He is an assistant professor of diplomacy and international relations at Tong Kong University in Taiwan. He says China would require more preparation and weaponry, such as artillery and missiles, attacking from the sea. Most importantly, Chen said, China needs to command the moral high ground through cognitive warfare and media discourse, he said. Talks between China and Taiwan ended in failure in 2016 after President Tsai Ing-wen took office. Her political party opposes unification with China. Chinese Air Force planes fly through Taiwan's air defense identification zone almost every day. China has never ruled out using force to unite the two sides. Alexander Wang is chairman of a military strategy research center in Taipei. He said China would look for a battle centered on disabling military systems and the ousting of Taiwanese leadership. Like the rest of the world, China is witnessing the world's reaction to Russia's invasion and war in Ukraine. Chinese officials are likely rethinking their predictions on how the world might treat China if it attacked Taiwan, said Tong Zhao. He is with the Tsinghua Center for Global Policy in Beijing. China is very surprised by the West's reaction to the war, Zhao says. I think this shows that even Russian experts didn't know there was going to be such strong international support to Ukraine. I think Chinese experts are starting to reevaluate these strategies and policies. China depends more on foreign countries for economic strength than Russia does. China exported almost 15% of the world's total manufactured goods from 1978 to 2020, UN estimates show. Officials in Beijing are probably seeking a non-military solution to the dispute, Alexander Huang said. Taiwan and China have disagreed since 2016 on how to treat each other, as separate countries, parts of China, or something else. The Ukraine war has signaled to China that disaster could result from a failed military solution. That, Huang said, might lead Beijing to think more about other measures. I'm Katie Weaver.
For the past week, Argentina was home to the first ever Women's Polo World Cup. The event, held from April 9th to 16th, included teams from Argentina, the United States, England, Ireland, Brazil, and Italy. Italian Argentine polo player Camila Rossi plays for Italy. 10 years ago, she said, there were no teams for girls. When she started the sport, she played on boys' teams. Back then, she added, the boys gave her funny looks. For American Erica Gundacomar, the tournament is a dream come true. She said that for a long time, leaders of the sport in the United States refused to start a women's team. Polo has been dominated by men for a long time, she said, and now women are being heard. Horacio Areco is the Argentina president of the International Polo Federation. He said it is impressive how many women started playing in recent years. Sports historians say polo is one of the world's oldest team sports. Until recently, it was always played by men. The sport is played with two teams on a field about 275 meters long. Each team has four players who ride horses. They score points by hitting a ball through the other team's goal. The players on horseback use long wooden sticks called mallets to hit the ball. The game came to Argentina with the arrival of immigrants from Great Britain in the 1800s. Today, Argentina has a long polo tradition. It also trains horses for the sport and sends them to polo players around the world. The horses can cost up to $100,000. Rossi said with the arrival of the World Cup, the sport can be promoted and grown around the world. Clara Casino is a player from Argentina. She said, the growth of women's polo has been so impressive. She noted that the sport is now growing more quickly for women than for men. About 5 years ago, another women's polo competition took place in Argentina. It was held at the same time as a men's tournament. Many of today's players say that tournament made Great Britain and the United States more interested in starting women's teams. Azucena Uranga is a member of the team from Argentina. She called the World Cup event an incredible opportunity. Uranga's father, Delphine, is the president of Argentina's Polo Association. He said his country's leadership in the sport is important because other countries often follow Argentina's example. It sends a message to the world, he said, to give women an opportunity to compete at the same level as men. I'm Dan Friedel.
Mm-hmm. Hello. This week on Ask a Teacher, we will answer a question from Vietnam. Dear VOA, I am writing because I want to know the difference between oneself and by oneself. Can you explain it to me? Thanks a lot. Biet Tan, Vietnam. Thank you for your question. Oneself is a reflexive pronoun. A reflexive pronoun describes the subject of a sentence. We can use it when the subject and the object of the sentence describe the same person. Other reflexive pronouns include myself, yourself, herself, himself, and themselves. Oneself is also a third-person singular pronoun, like herself or himself, but it does not show gender. It can describe a male or female. Here is an example with oneself. A selfie is a picture one takes of oneself. In this example, the subject of the clause one is taking a picture of oneself and no one else. We can see oneself is describing the subject. In American English, oneself is formal and rarely appears in everyday speech. It is mostly used in academic writing. Instead of oneself, most speakers use yourself when talking about another person directly in informal speech. When working from home, one often talks to oneself. When working from home, you often talk to yourself. And now for by oneself. By is a preposition. Although it has other meanings, when used with a reflexive pronoun, it means alone or without help. One could carry this television by oneself. In this sentence, one does not need any help to carry the TV. One can do it alone. We can rewrite this sentence in everyday speech. You could carry this television by yourself. Sometimes we use a reflexive pronoun without by. This usage may have the same meaning as by plus reflexive pronoun. You could carry the TV yourself. I hope these examples have helped you to understand the difference with reflexive pronouns and using oneself. What question do you have about American English? Send us an email at learningenglish@voanews.com. And that's Ask a Teacher. I'm Faith Perlow.
Now, the Special English Program, American Stories. Our story today is called Rappaccini's Daughter. It was written by Nathaniel Hawthorne. We will tell the story in two parts. Here is Kay Gallant with the first part of our story.
Many years ago, a young man named Giovanni Guasconti left his home in Naples to study in northern Italy. He rented a small room on the top floor of a dark and ancient palace. Long ago, the building had belonged to a noble family. Now, an old woman, Signora Lisabetta, rented its rooms to students at the University of Padua. Giovanni's room had a small window. From it, he could see a large garden that had many plants and flowers. "Does the garden belong to you?" he asked Signora Lisabetta one day. "Oh, no," she said quickly. "That garden belongs to the famous doctor, Giacomo Rappaccini. People say he uses those plants to make strange kinds of medicine. He lives in that small brown house in the garden with his daughter Beatrice." Giovanni often sat by his window to look at the garden. He had never seen so many different kinds of plants. They all had enormous green leaves and magnificent flowers in every color of the rainbow. Giovanni's favorite plant was in a white marble vase near the house. It was covered with big purple flowers. One day, while Giovanni was looking out his window, he saw an old man in a black cape walking in the garden. The old man was tall and thin. His face was an unhealthy yellow color. His black eyes were very cold. The old man wore thick gloves on his hands and a mask over his mouth and nose. He walked carefully among the plants, as if he were walking among wild animals or poisonous snakes. Although he looked at the flowers very closely, he did not touch or smell any of them. When the old man arrived at the plant with the big purple flowers, he stopped. He took off his mask and called loudly, "Beatrice, come help me." "I am coming, Father. What do you want?" answered a warm young voice from inside the house. A young woman came into the garden. Her thick, dark hair fell around her shoulders in curls. Her cheeks were pink, and her eyes were large and black. She seemed full of life, health, and energy as she walked among the plants. Giovanni thought she was as beautiful as the purple flowers in the marble vase. The old man said something to her. She nodded her head as she touched and smelled the flowers that her father had been so careful to avoid. Several weeks later, Giovanni went to visit Pietro Baglioni, a friend of his father's. Professor Baglioni taught medicine at the university. During the visit, Giovanni asked about Dr. Rappaccini. "He is a great scientist," Professor Baglioni replied, "but he is also a dangerous man." "Why?" asked Giovanni. The older man shook his head slowly. "Because Rappaccini cares more about science than he does about people. He has created many terrible poisons from the plants in his garden. He thinks he can cure sickness with these poisons. It is true that several times he has cured a very sick person that everyone thought would die. But Rappaccini's medicine has also killed many people. I think he would sacrifice any life, even his own, for one of his experiments." "But what about his daughter?" Giovanni said. "I'm sure he loves her." The old professor smiled at the young man. "So," he said, "you have heard about Beatrice Rappaccini. People say she is very beautiful. But few men in Padua have ever seen her. She never leaves her father's garden." Giovanni left Professor Baglioni's house as the sun was setting. On his way home, he stopped at a flower shop where he bought some fresh flowers. He returned to his room and sat by the window. Very little sunlight was left. The garden was quiet. The purple flowers on Giovanni's favorite plant seemed to glow in the evening's fading light. Then someone came out of the doorway of the little brown house. It was Beatrice. She entered the garden and walked among the plants. She bent to touch the leaves of a plant or to smell a flower. Rappaccini's daughter seemed to grow more beautiful with each step. When she reached the purple plant, she buried her face in its flowers. Giovanni heard her say, "Give me your breath, my sister. The ordinary air makes me weak. And give me one of your beautiful flowers." Beatrice gently broke off one of the largest flowers. As she lifted it to put it in her dark hair, a few drops of liquid from the flower fell to the ground. One of the drops landed on the head of a tiny lizard crawling near the feet of Beatrice. For a moment, the small animal twisted violently. Then it moved no more. Beatrice did not seem surprised. She sighed and placed the flower in her hair. Giovanni leaned out of the window so he could see her better. At this moment, a beautiful butterfly flew over the garden wall. It seemed to be attracted by Beatrice and flew once around her head. Then the insect's bright wings stopped and it fell to the ground dead. Beatrice shook her head sadly. Suddenly, she looked up at Giovanni's window. She saw the young man looking at her. Giovanni picked up the flowers he had bought and threw them down to her. "Young lady," he said, "wear these flowers as a gift from Giovanni Guasconti." "Thank you," Beatrice answered. She picked up the flowers from the ground and quickly ran to the house. She stopped at the door for a moment to wave shyly at Giovanni. It seemed to him that his flowers were beginning to turn brown in her hands. For many days, the young man stayed away from the window that looked out on Rappaccini's garden. He wished he had not talked to Beatrice, because now he felt under the power of her beauty. He was a little afraid of her, too. He could not forget how the little lizard and the butterfly had died. One day, while he was returning home from his classes, he met Professor Baglioni on the street. "Well, Giovanni," the old man said, "have you forgotten me?" Then he looked closely at the young man. "What is wrong, my friend? Your appearance has changed since the last time we met." It was true. Giovanni had become very thin. His face was white, and his eyes seemed to burn with fever. As they stood talking, a man dressed in a long black cape came down the street. He moved slowly, like a person in poor health. His face was yellow, but his eyes were sharp and black. It was the man Giovanni had seen in the garden. As he passed them, the old man nodded coldly to Professor Baglioni, but he looked at Giovanni with a great deal of interest. "It's Dr. Rappaccini," Professor Baglioni whispered after the old man had passed them. Has he ever seen your face before? Giovanni shook his head. No, he answered. I don't think so. Professor Baglioni looked worried. I think he has seen you before. I know that cold look of his. He looks the same way when he examines an animal he has killed in one of his experiments. Giovanni, I will bet my life on it. You are the subject of one of Rappaccini's experiments. Giovanni stepped away from the old man. You are joking, he said. No, I'm serious. The professor took Giovanni's arm. Be careful, my young friend. You are in great danger. Giovanni pulled his arm away. I must be going, he said. Good night. As Giovanni hurried to his room, he felt confused and a little frightened. Signora Lisabetta was waiting for him outside his door. She knew he was interested in Beatrice. I have good news for you, she said. I know where there is a secret entrance into Rappaccini's garden. Giovanni could not believe his ears. Where is it? He asked. Show me the way.
You have just heard part one of the story called Rappaccini's Daughter. It was written by Nathaniel Hawthorne and adapted for Special English by Donna DeSantis. Your storyteller was Kay Galland. Listen next week for the final part of our story. This is Shep O'Neill.
And that's our program for today. Listen again tomorrow to learn English through stories from around the world. I'm Jonathan Evans.
And I'm Ashley Thompson.